let me go to Ron Breslow, where we don't have much time, 69, and he's a senator now.
I mean, I came back to the Senate now because I was concerned about some particular issues in the campus, and I decided this is the place where they get settled. It really works. It really works. I was concerned about the assignment of space in the wonderful new building on the corner of 120th and Broadway, you know, this interdisciplinary science building, and how it was all being done. I joined the Senate, joined the committee that looks into the whole thing, and been raising hell in that committee ever since, right? And so you will testify.
Thank you very much, President.
That's right. Okay, and other things of that sort. It's really the place where things happen. But let me tell you a little bit about what I remember about how we got the thing started. There's been awful big emphasis on doing it in order to satisfy the needs of the students. And I agree there was a big piece of that too. But the fact is the faculty were quite unhappy also about the sense that they had very little interaction. They didn't see trustees and they were not sure exactly who it is that was making the decisions. And when we saw the way that this strike was being handled, I think we lost even more whatever respect we had for the administration. Ted Barry mentioned Cordier. Let me tell you how Cordier handled things in contrast to what was done there. After he became the president, there was still a certain amount of ferment in the place, and a group of students said to him, "We demand to speak to you tomorrow." He's a real president. He said, "Okay, that's fine. Let me look at my book." He said, "I see I have an opening at 6:30 tomorrow morning. Would that be all right?" And that was the last he heard of it. Well, I mean, there's a world of difference between that and saying, who do you think you are, etc. You know, I mean, it really is, it really said, if you guys really care about this, you'll show up at 6:30. If you don't really care, you're just trying to make a case about something, you're not going to make the case with me. I was involved in the Bill McGill business. Let me tell you how that actually happened. Because the Senate by then consisted of faculty and also of students, there were three committees appointed to find Cordier's successor. There was a faculty committee, there was a student committee, and there was a trustees committee. And the faculty committee and the student committee, after a certain amount of just meeting with each other, decided we would become one committee, because really, what the students had to contribute was terrific. We could talk to faculty in other institutions about how they felt about the possible candidate. They could talk to students in other institutions about how people felt about that guy. And so we found that was really very helpful. The trustees eventually decided that we seemed to have a better idea of what to do than they did. And ultimately, because I knew Bill McGill, ultimately they agreed with our decision that we should hire, that we should get Bill McGill. And they gave me the wonderful job of flying out to the University of California, San Diego, and convincing him to move to New York. Now, this was February. We had usual weather in February here. There were whales off the coast of where his living spouting in the air. And my job was to convince him to come. And that was really directly, I think, because of my connection in the Senate that this whole thing got going. But my position with him, which I think is still absolutely correct, is that the presidency of Columbia University is an unbelievable opportunity to take what everybody calls the bully pulpit and get noticed. People can come up and film you by taking a taxi up from the major organizations and then going home again and filing their reports. You can appear in the New York Times, you can appear on television. We see that there are many presidents who do take advantage of that. Lee does that now. And I think it was a wonderful opportunity, so he was in fact willing to go. But the main thing was that by then the students really had a role in the thing, and it was a sensible role. In the Senate, there was a lot of back and forth there, but mostly extremely good natured. And I would say there were questions about investments, but then one of the students got up and he said, "Well, I really think we have to revise our investment policy, but all I know about is bank CDs, and I don't know that much more about investments." It was fine. It was relatively good natured, and there was not a lot of fighting about it. The big issue now, I'll tell you, is the Senate. The Senate is now dealing with a big issue in which the students and the faculty are to some extent on opposite sides. And that has to do with the academic calendar. The student position is, if you wait until after Labor Day to start your classes, you have an excellent chance, if Labor Day is late, an excellent chance of getting exams on the 23rd of December, which certainly interferes with the rest of their lives. And of course, it's not so wonderful for us either. We have to grade these exams after the 23rd of December. And so their position is they would like to start at a well-defined time certain. And if Labor Day comes later than that, fine. That's the day's vacation. They would like to start at a time certain. And some of the faculty are concerned that this will interfere with their vacation plans or whatever. It's going to get resolved. It's going to get resolved, and it's not a battle between the students and the faculty. They have presented their arguments. About some faculty presented various arguments. Maybe we don't have to have the election day off and the day before election day. And the students said, no, we really like that as a break in the term. You get a break in the spring. We like to have a break in the fall. I mean, it's all back and forth, reasonable conversation. I should admit I'm now a convert to the student position. I think they're right. And I'm going to see if I can convince the rest of my faculty that's also true. But yeah.
Professor Breslow, I as the head of the Student Affairs Committee, I hope to update you that it has been resolved, and we will vote on it on April 30th. The Education Committee came to a consensus where literally we locked
the window into the library because one of his very good friends, one of his very good friends, he was the poet laureate of England. I was boosting the poet laureate of England into the Law Library. I mean, this was not war to the death. This was, to some extent, the passion play, right? It was really quite an interesting experience. I think all of us who were part of it felt that it was really a terribly educational and in some ways, a very, very, very educational experience. And then the business with the police, I mean, that was really terrible, and it didn't have to happen that way. Some of you will know that police came on the campus earlier, not to beat people up, but just to protect certain things. And so they went into the library and went into the president's office. And the students there thought, well, this is it. We're going to be escorted out of here, and that's going to be the end of the occupation. They didn't do that. They took away some of the valuable paintings and left, leaving the kids there. I mean, it was really, they were not there to beat anybody up. It's eventually, of course, it happened. That was a terrible thing. And I think nobody can put the kind of gloss on that one. That was really an awful experience, and I feel sorry for the people involved in it, obviously. It went on for quite a while. As you know, it became symbolic, and then things happened all over the country. Some things much worse than here. People were actually murdered in some other places. We never got to that level, but we became symbolic because of this wonderful contact we had with the press. The year after the riots, when everything was fine, there was a cover, Newsweek magazine had a cover saying, "New Trouble at Columbia." The trouble at Columbia was that a certain number of students had been told that they could not come back that next year. They had to be suspended for a while. And they were there arguing with the registrar about whether they should be allowed to vote. But somebody got a photograph of that and played it on as if the riot was still persisting. Of course, there was no such thing. So we do get great coverage when we win something, like when we won the tennis tournament, I guess you guys know, we're now Ivy League champions in tennis. We got very good coverage of that. We used to get great coverage of everyone. Every athlete who actually turned out to be pretty good, and was always a surprise. we used to get great coverage of that. It's really a focal place. I mean, it really has a very focal role in the world, and I'm glad it's now being run in a reasonable, sensible way, and that was one of the good things that came out of this. Thanks very much.